What's up, guys? It's Sunday again. I want to say welcome back to our online student ministry videos. I hope these have been an encouragement to you. We would love to know how we can make these better. So if you get a chance, maybe comment or message us and let us know what you think. We are doing these for you, and so we want to make sure that they're fitting what you want, what you need. If I talk too much, I'd like to know that. But either way, today I want to give a shout out to Riley Cornett, who did our video for us on Wednesday. And if that's something you'd be interested in doing as well, please, please, please let us know, because I'd love to hook you up with that and get you plugged in there. Today we're going to talk about faith, and no, not you, Faith Tackett, or you, Faith Uchuck. Hi, by the way. I want us to look at faith as how it affects whatever we do when nobody's watching, how it affects our inner thoughts. If you're like me and you've been stuck at home for a while now, we got a lot of free time, right? We got a lot of time to sit and ponder and think, and probably not so much as we want to do that, but we have those opportunities right now. And I think that our faith impacts a lot of what those times look like for us, what we do with our time when nobody's watching, what we think about when we're by ourselves or we're bored out of our mind. And so I want you to pause this video. I want you to read Mark chapter 10. And when you're good done with that, I want you to come back and join us, and we're going to walk through it together. Hey, I hope you took a few minutes to read that passage. It's really important that you read scripture. Matter of fact, if you have to pick between listening to me or reading scripture, I would rather you read scripture, because you're going to get a whole lot more out of it that way. It's God's direct word to us. It matters a lot, and that's why I think it's really, really important. So if you do nothing else the rest of this week, read as much of your Bible as you can. It's super, super important. For the sake of our discussion today, we're going to kind of skip past the first 12 verses. It deals with marriage and divorce and Old Testament law and custom from that time. And while it's important as it relates to our discussion today, it's not as big of a deal. If that's something you want to talk about, I would love to talk with you about it. So be sure to message us or put something in the comments, and we'll get in touch with you. But for the sake of our conversation today, we're going to start in verse number 13. When you get here, you got the story of Jesus and these kids. They come up to him. The disciples don't want them around. They think they're obnoxious and annoying. Probably you feel the same way about some little kids in your life. Anyway, they push them away, and Jesus says, no. Now, you missed the whole boat here. If you want to be part of God's kingdom, you've got to have faith and trust, just like a little kid has faith and trust. Well, what does that look like? And I think it's this way. I think it's a blind trust, right? A little kid, if they trust you, is going to jump off anything that they can find into your arms if they know that you're going to be there and they'll catch them. Matter of fact, they're willing to jump off things and do things that could kill them, and they don't care. Like, that doesn't even register in their little brains, because as far as they're concerned, their mom or their dad or their you, if you like hanging out with kids, whoever's there that they trust is going to catch them regardless of what they do. My own kids do that all the time. They'll jump off things. I'm like, wow, if I hadn't been here to catch you, you would be dead right now. But that's what our faith is supposed to look like when it comes to God, that we're willing to literally throw ourselves off the cliff, trusting that God is going to take care of us and is going to catch us when we do that. Now, some would say, well, that's really reckless. Like, that's crazy. And yeah, I can see how it would seem that way. But in effect, when you think about that kind of faith and you apply that to our life now, you and you're 15, 16, some of you are like 14-ish or 13-ish, or some of you are hitting the upper limits of 18. You're about to graduate high school, we hope, right? You know, with all the stuff going on, that's kind of crazy. But either way, regardless of where you are in your life stage, that's the kind of faith that Jesus expects from us. A blind trust that's willing to leap into his arms when something is not going the way it's supposed to, or when he asks us to do something, which I think is even more important. I really think when it comes to that, that's where the adventure comes in following God, right? We have this idea that Christianity or following God is some sort of, I don't know, is you just do your thing. You go to church, you read your Bible, you pray, and you maybe tell someone about Jesus every once in a while. That's kind of boring, if we're being honest. Like, and then you get situations like this where church doesn't happen the way it normally does. Well, 50% of your Christianity is now gone. So what do you do with that? Well, I think that following God, I think that having a relationship with God and being part of his kingdom is so much more than just going to church. That's great that we get to do that, but God has called us to live an adventure that is so much bigger than anything that normal American Christianity deals with than we could ever imagine. I've said this before. I think that if Jesus lived in our time and he came and called you to be his disciple, I am 100% sure that most of your parents would probably look at that and say, no, that dude is on a one-way track to rebellion and he's going to get killed one day. That's probably what's going to happen. Well, here's the deal. Jesus hasn't changed. His mission hasn't changed. His message hasn't changed. The world's response to that message hasn't changed, nor has Jesus stopped calling people like you and me to follow him. So what's changed in there? Well, what's changed is you and me. We're too comfy sitting on our nice, comfortable couches that our wives hate, except you don't have a wife because you're too young for that. But we get really comfortable doing life the way that we want to do it. And we miss out on the adventure that's out there that comes from a very simple faith. You don't have to have some special call from God to do the things that he's asked you to do. He's already asked you to do things. You just have to trust him and jump and make it happen. When, this is kind of a side note here, when you look at this passage, Jesus cared a lot about little kids. Like, that's kind of the side piece of these verses right here in 13, 14, 15, and 16. Ergo, so should we. Kids look up to you a lot, especially those that are way younger than you are to them. You are a giant. And you have a lot of influence in their life. So please, please, please don't waste that. It's really, really important. When you look at the next set of verses here in verse 17, I'm going to kind of treat these from verse 17 to 31 as kind of the same unit here. You got the story of this rich guy. Matter of fact, my Bible says he was a rich young guy. He's got a lot of things and he's proud, right? He's probably worked really hard to get where he is. And he comes to Jesus with these questions like, hey, I've been a good guy. I've done the things that I'm supposed to do. Things are going really, really well for me. What else can I do to inherit eternal life? And he's looking for Jesus to say, yeah, you're good. Good job, buddy. You should be part of the party. Come hang out with us. And that's not what Jesus says. Jesus doesn't care at all about any of the stuff that this young guy has done in his life. He looks at him and says, you love your riches more than anything else. And if you really want to be my disciple, if you really want to follow me, that's what needs to leave from your life. Now, it's kind of freaks his disciples out because he makes a statement. He says in verse 25, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. I didn't grab one and I should have because my wife sews and she's got these little needles and it's super, super small. Like to fit a thread through the end of that needle. And he says it's easier for a camel to fit through there than it is for someone who is wealthy to enter God's kingdom. Why is that? Well, the reality is people a lot of times in that position trust in their ability to take care of themselves. They trust in what they've accumulated to sustain them. Matter of fact, you see that all the time with people right now in our time and culture as they begin to hoard their supplies and hoard things like food and toilet paper. Like, are you kidding me? Like toilet paper? You can't like eat that. It's ridiculous. If you've hoarded toilet paper, I expect you to send a piece to every single person in our class because, well, that's just not cool. Anyway, side note, back to where we need to be. When we get to this situation here, these people trust in what they have over what God can do for them. They've created their own safety net, if you will. And I wonder, like, how often do we do that? We do a bunch of good things to make us feel good, but we don't actually follow Jesus, right? That's what this guy was doing. He wanted to do a bunch of things that would make him good, but at the end of the day, he wasn't actually following Jesus. He wasn't actually trusting God with everything that he had. And so when Jesus challenges him with that, he walks away. He's sad because that's too much. He's not willing to surrender all of that. He's given up living life maybe the way he wanted to live, but he's not willing to give up his stuff because that's his safety net. That's where he takes his refuge and his comfort. I think that for this guy to follow, it was going to require complete and total surrender of his stuff. And I think the same thing happens for us. That if we're actually going to follow Jesus, it requires complete and total surrender of everything that we do. Now, I want you to think about this because some of you are probably looking at this and say, wow, either my family's got a lot of stuff. Or does that mean we have to get rid of it? Not necessarily. What I want you to understand is that those types of things will leave you anyway. So if you spend your entire life working to gain those things, working to be financially stable, working to have the nice car or the nice house. At some point, you are going to die. That's going to be over for you, whether that's a car wreck that takes your life or you live to the ripe old age of 110 and you finally keel over because, I don't know, you ate a bad can of Manwich or something like that. It doesn't matter to me. At some point, you are going to die. And when you're dead, all the things you've accumulated in life will not matter. What will matter most is your relationship to the kingdom of God and where you fit. Have you followed? Have you trusted? Have you surrendered? When you get into those things, it really matters. It matters that you surrender and that you trust that God is going to provide for you. God used really wealthy people as his disciples and part of his kingdom. God also used people that were dirt poor. It doesn't matter about wealth or not wealth. It matters what you trust. The next part of this starts in verse 32. That him and the disciples are walking, and Jesus makes this statement that, again, he's going to be killed. They're going to make fun of him. They're going to spit on him. But after 3 days, he's going to rise again from the dead. When you get into verse 35, you get James and John, who are kind of separate themselves from the rest of the disciples. And they ask Jesus, like, hey, can you, like, promote us when we get there? Can I sit on your right hand? Can I sit on your left? You know, one of those things. They start to try to elevate themselves. They're looking for that fast track to glory. And that's not anywhere where Jesus wanted them. And he finishes it up here in verse 42 in this little segment with this statement. He says, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles, which just meant anybody who wasn't Jewish, they lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. You see, there isn't any getting ahead in the kingdom of God. There isn't any working for advancement or working for promotion in God's kingdom. It's doing the will of Father, of the Father, and it's learning to serve in the way that Jesus modeled. If you think about that, this guy is, Jesus is the most powerful being in the universe. And he shows up, he washes people's feet, he heals them, he takes care of them, he hangs out with the people that nobody else wanted to hang out with. And he extended love and compassion to the people that were most hated in his society. He came as a ransomer to give his life for those people, for everyone. And that's the same sort of service and humility that to be part of God's kingdom, he requires of you and he requires of me, that he requires us to serve and to love others above ourselves. It's not about getting the promotion. It's not about getting to the top or being the best. If anything, you want to be the best servant. That's where that comes into. It's about serving other people and being humble. The last part of this chapter is a story that happens outside the city of Jericho. And if you read it, you're probably a little confused because it says as he was leaving Jericho and as he was coming into Jericho, you need to understand there was like two parts of Jericho. There was an old Jericho and a new Jericho, and they were right down the road from each other. The best way I can think about this now, we talk about Detroit as everywhere. Like if you go outside the country, you probably tell people you're from Detroit, even though you live in Southgate or you live in Wyandotte. You know, there's Detroit where everybody started. But then there's the rest of us that don't actually live in Detroit, but we basically live in Detroit. And so if you could imagine like from wherever you live, whether that's Taylor or Riverview or Wyandotte or whatever, like if there was nothing between your town and Detroit, Jesus is like in the middle of those two, if that makes sense for you. Either way, you got this situation. You've got Bartimaeus. He's blind. He's a beggar. He starts calling out for Jesus to have mercy on him, to fix him. And people are telling him, shut up, get out of the way. He doesn't want to listen to you. He doesn't care about you. But this blind guy has so much faith that he keeps shouting and keeps trying to get Jesus' attention to the point where Jesus finally stops and says, what do you want from me? He goes, what do you want me to do for you in verse 50? And the blind man says, I want to be able to see. He has this faith that Jesus can fix him. And Jesus says this, go your way. Your faith has made you whole. It's another one of these situations where because somebody believed that Jesus was capable, he changed their life. And so as we wrap this up this morning, I want you to leave you with this, kind of to put everything in perspective. I got four things for you. The first piece of this, and we're talking about when it was back to the kids at the beginning, is that faith in Jesus, in some respects, needs to be like a blind trust, just like a kid is. If you're gonna start this faith process, or even if you've been in this process for a long time, if you're gonna be where you need to be, you need to have that blind trust like a kid does. You just trust him and then act. Trust him and jump. Trust him and do. That's how that works. The second part of this is that faith let me back up a second. It's faith that God will provide even if you give up your security. We see that with the rich young ruler. God will take care of you as long as you're willing to jump off that cliff and follow him, which means you have to walk away from some things that might seem the things like you're supposed to do. The responsible way of life might look differently for someone who follows the name of Jesus. You might be asked to move somewhere. You might be asked to choose a career path that doesn't have a guaranteed form of income. that might look crazy to your grandparents or to your teachers or even to your parents. God has always, always, always promised to protect and take care of this. Matter of fact, he says in verse number 30, or I'm sorry, in verse number 29, he says, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel who will not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions. It's not gonna be easy. And in the age to come, eternal life. In other words, yeah, it's going to suck. Things aren't going to go the way that they're supposed to all the time. But you have the promise of eternal life, and you have the promise that God is going to provide those things for you now that you need to do life. So that's the second one. It's faith that God will provide even if you give up your security. Number three, it's faith that the present sacrifice is worth it in the end. See, the disciples, when they chose to follow Jesus, they walked away from taking over their family business. They walked away from getting rich. They walked away from becoming somebody in their culture, in their time, and they chose to be humble, simple guys that followed a very humble, simple man. When those guys dealt with the sacrifice of their own life and ultimately the hurt and the pain and the prison and the torture, the executions that they went through, all of it for them was worth it in the end because they gained a position with Jesus that's unlike anything else they could have gained on earth. The present sacrifice was worth it in the end. The last part of this is that it's faith that God can and will change our circumstances. The blind guy wasn't content to be blind. He had faith that God could change everything about his life, and he does it. He just had to be loud enough and persistent enough. It's faith in Jesus, in some respects, needs to be like a blind trust, like a kid. It's faith that God will provide even if you give up your security. It's faith that the present sacrifice is worth it in the end, and it's faith that God can and will change our circumstances. I think that everything rides on faith, including the choices we make when nobody's watching, including our deepest inner thoughts. You say, Brad, how does that have anything to do with what we just talked about? Well, here's the deal. Jesus cares just as much about your life while you're at your home right now as he does when you're not in your home, when you're at school and everywhere else, which means it matters how you live your life right now in your home, bored out of your mind. It matters what you believe about Jesus. Does Jesus actually care about what happens in your mind? Does Jesus care about what you do with your free time? Absolutely, because that's where we demonstrate our faith. I think that it's here that we take refuge in the security of the things that we've collected or our abilities that we achieve. It's here sometimes we say, wow, I can rest easy. My parents have got this covered. Or hey, you know, maybe, you know, my parents lost a job, but we're still going to be okay. You know, this is the time that often we take refuge in who we are, or we're going to be okay. We're safe in our house. But it's often here we give into sin. We give into temptation. And we get kind of stuck in this mindset that nobody knows but me. Well, that's not true. The Bible says that God is the great discerner of hearts. He knows what's happening inside of us, and he can divide our thoughts. It's here that we have to choose to have faith that God cares about what's going on inside of us, that it's worth it to deny ourselves and follow Jesus. And that, I think, is where faith begins. It begins in the quiet moments of your room when you're sitting there by yourself and you have to decide what you're going to allow to enter your mind and stay there. What you're going to allow yourself to do and act on and communicate to the people that you're talking with, that's where faith meets the road. Are you going to have faith that God actually has a plan? Are you going to have faith that God cares about you? Are you going to have faith that God can change your circumstances? And are you willing to act on that now, even when you're by yourself? That's what I want to leave you with this morning, give you some things to think about. Let me encourage you to keep reading. Again, if you are doing our 3x3 challenge, we are somewhere in the book of Romans. I would love it if you would post in the comments of this video and just tell us where you are. We'd love to know and kind of see what's happening for you and in your family. Send us a picture of what you're doing. I don't know, if you're bored, go outside, go running, go do something you'd like to do for fun. But we miss you guys, and we're hoping to get back together again soon. See ya.